we really need to not just halt this devastation, we need to turn it around. And conversations that need to be had, like capitalism versus the climate. Well, I'm going to be on the side of Mother Nature every time, because in the end, Mother Nature always gets her way. Be each other's medicine. Whatever healing you can provide for yourself, for someone else, do that. And the way forward is together, united, whatever title people fall under. But when those lines become invisible to each other, that's when we actually become one.
Why are we interested? Why are we here tonight? Well, because Naomi Klein's new book, This Changes Everything, Capital and versus the Climate, is the most important, wide-ranging, well-written, timely, hard-hitting book about climate justice so far. How many in the audience have actually read it? Okay, keep your hands up if you've read all of it. Okay, just to know, I believe there's signed copies back there, and there's only like about 15, 20 of them, so make sure you grab one before you go. Just to continue with what John Forum said, it is all of these things, not because it gets everything right. This guy is a lefty, he's an eco-socialist, so we all have critiques, and there's critiques all over the map from left to right, and from people who aren't political, it's not political. Not because it gets everything right, but because it allows those of us who have been searching for ways forward to deal with the climate crisis in a more substantial way, it allows us to take a few more steps. So we're doing what is happening, and I hope happens a lot more, is we're having a community engagement around a book that allows us to do this. For a book on the New York Times nonfiction bestseller list to bring the message that we need to go beyond capitalism to survive the climate crisis is a major step forward. Whether this is all new, or their critiques from the left and the right, that this book should be read and discussed. It's a very engaging book, right? It's a great mixture of empirical facts, history. There's a lot of personal story in here, a lot more than her past books, and I'll mention that in a couple of minutes. I've read most of the book, and certainly followed lots of articles. There's so much critique from the left, right, all sorts of sides in the book. And there's certainly a lot to say about, organizing the chapters and what she presents. In one of her interviews, I just got a little bit more of a sense of personally what was involved in writing this. I would bet that most of you have gone through some sort of process where you've given yourself over emotionally to this issue of climate change, right? It affects all of us. I certainly have. I'm doing a dissertation on climate science and what's going on with the climate crisis. One can't help but take this seriously, if they take this seriously, to go through some sort of traumatic experience. There's a lot of writers who talk about this. There's actually a word I used this morning, I learned this morning, solecism, I think it is. What is it? There's a new word that is about emotions and what people are feeling, affective responses for climate change. Anyway, my sense from this interview and reading the book is the book is bookended by some personal statements. It was a 5-year process. She didn't quite know who she was writing it for in the first couple of years. Then she caught on that she was witnessing out there a growing and powerful grassroots movement. And she, when she saw that, and it was the same kind of process I went through in a much more minor way, but she was able to think and start writing about something positive about this whole thing, right? And in those 3 years, more and more, it started to feel like a movement of movements. And you know, with Naomi Klein, she seems to be in the right place for the right time in her 3 books, right? And she was suspecting this, another movement of movements was happening. I experienced this in New York, right, along with Angelique. And Stephen was there too, actually, in New York. That there was a real sense there. I Sorry, am I going over time?
Yes, you are.
What did we notice? That this was unprecedented. 400,000 people out there. They were expecting 1,000, right? There's something really happening out there, and we're all part of this right now. So this was her way to fight denial and get past this sort of immobility that happens to all of us in the face of this big stark thing. And I know that it's harder to get to that point when you know that this problem isn't a light problem to deal with. It's not about just reducing those numbers of CO2 that is going into the atmosphere. This whole book is about a substantive critique and looking at the fundamental elements within society that are preventing us from dealing with this problem, right? So it's when I'd sort of gotten the sense of that with her, and I think this is a real profound thing that she did for all of us to be able to articulate this. And we have a bit of a responsibility, I think, to go on where she left off, take this and bring it into the community and talk about it. That's part of the rationale for what we're doing tonight. She talks about bad timing, right? That the climate crisis arrives at the same time as what she calls neoliberalism, an ideological project, importantly, standing in the way of our ability to act. Okay, so at the time when it is, what is called for in dealing with this climate crisis is collective action and rational action and people getting together and talking and mobilizing to do something. At a time when that is most needed for this most critical, potentially terminal crisis that we're all heading towards, we have a cultural milieu which is shaped by what she calls neoliberalism, this idea of competitive, isolated individualism, where we're all separate. Neoliberalism and the market system is, in terms of a project, is a model for restructuring all relations. So, she goes into this in a big way. And the great thing is that I can say these radical things, right? The idea is that there's a small elite there, that it's the same elite that in the 60s and the 70s said there is too much democracy. It's the same number of think tanks and ideologues. 5 minutes, that's great, thank you. It's the same group of corporate subsidized marketers and intellectuals who are rolling out this have rolled out this climate denialism, right? Same group that talked about there's too much democracy. So this is one of her main things, is this bad timing. Her main thesis, of course, is we're in the midst of capitalism versus the climate. So now the idea here is that we have to look at the climate issue a little bit differently than people who are sort of inside the system, inside the capitalist system. I think that Angelia is likely going to address this, and I'm sure others will touch on it. There's a problem with false solutions, right? That within the system, there's all sorts of market mechanisms at the highest level, in terms of the Kyoto processes. We've understood climate science has allowed us to understand this huge problem. But on the other hand, it's the solutions that they're bringing to bear on this huge, deep historical problem that goes back several hundred years to the origins of our market-based capitalist society right now. It's a very deep, profound problem. The solutions that are out there, that are mainstream and that are prominent, that are keep on being talked about amongst all our governments at the international level and at all these international conferences, are very, very superficial. So the idea is here's a quote: "Climate change, like other environmental crises, is not the problem, but more accurately, it is the symptom of our socioeconomic system." Right, so it's a socioeconomic system. It's a hard job of reorganizing our socioeconomic system, the system that we call capitalism, that we need to look at. And that has all sorts of other implications about how we deal with climate change. It's not about just trying to get those numbers down. It's about restructuring society So the power relationships change. So the people, the democratic processes, are somehow percolate up and have some influence over the fate of the planet. And it isn't just the purview of a small elite deciding these things. Here's a quote: "What the climate needs to avoid collapse is a contraction in humanity's use of resources. What our economic model demands to avoid collapse is unfettered growth." There is simply an incompatibility between capitalism and a socially and ecologically healthy world, she argues. Another theme is betrayal of Big Green. And she points to, there's a great chapter that you really should look at, one of, you know, four or five I would point you to, that talks about some of the big environmental organizations: Environmental Defense Fund, Conservation International, Sierra Club to a certain extent, and how these organizations aren't really fighting genuinely for environmental health. They're neoliberal institutions. They're part of the whole conventional framework that is simply reproducing the problem, reproducing the capitalist system, capitalist framework. And I'm sure you've heard this. This is a couple of the quotes that come out there, right? A couple of these organizations are actually involved in resource extraction themselves and have been able to legitimize that. So there's lots more in terms of the content. Last couple issues I want to talk about is a hope. Where is the hope? Well, the hope she identifies in the counter-narrative to the Big Greens and to the think tanks, the think tanks of denial. The counter-narrative from the Global South, from First Nations, and the kind of frontline activists that we've seen up on Burnaby Mountain. Okay, so this counter-narrative comes from a couple things. It comes from, one, an increasing systemic analysis of what's going on. People are recognizing connections between environmental problems and social problems, and developing an analysis, like Klein does in this book, to connect those things. The other source, I think, comes from this, what she calls blockadia. Okay, I've got a couple more points and I'll go. Okay, so blockadia, right? Great chapter on blockadia. And this is a frontline grassroots movement that is providing leadership throughout the world right now. And it's taking leadership from the traditional institutionalized sources of governments and NGOs. And again, Burnaby Mount is a beautiful example of that. The heart and soul that really is at the base of what happened, that nothing else would have happened without it, was just a couple people, and then they brought a couple more people in, who just had this incredible ability to be offended by Kinder Morgan. I was there, right? I saw this. I walked in Drummond, walked with these people. I went down there and I didn't know what the heck necessarily I was doing. I thought, okay, so what's going to happen here? If they're going to bring out their change that they had, maybe I'll go stand in front of it, or I'll yell or something, right? Luckily, the cavalry came, and these people came out with their blowhorns, and they started screaming. They said, fuck you. They talked about climate change. They changed the power dynamic, and it was an emotional experience for me. And I thought, holy shit, can I do that? I don't think so. So there's that spirit out there that is at the root of a lot of this stuff, that it is wonderful to connect with and challenge yourself by. And I think that's partly what she's talking about with this whole blockadia thing. It's an existential reaction, an appropriate existential reaction, to a commensurate reaction to the level of what's going on out there, right? It might seem crazy to a lot of us, but we're talking about the termination of our life support systems. Anyway, I'm very impressed with that whole experience. The last point, that the right is right. She has this wonderful chapter, this counterintuitive kind of thing, where she's gone. We've gone to these conferences, and she's seen these, you know, these big wealthy Koch brothers kind of funded, Koch brothers kind of funded conferences, where they're looking at the problem, right? And the right says, here's a quote in the book: "If the science were true, then the left would be able to do just about anything." I mean, they realize the implications of this. If it really is so bad, then of course we're going to need state intervention in the economy. Of course we're going to need government to intervene in multiple ways to turn things around. So they understand this, and that's why they're so so much into denial. They spend so much money denying the issue of climate change itself. Now, I'm a lefty, right? I hang out with people who like to critique liberalism and that kind of thing. And there's a lot of liberal critique. There's a lot of critiques of Naomi Klein from that standpoint. There's a lot of critiques from all sorts of standpoints. I'm going to reserve that. There's another discussion actually on Friday where we'll talk about that a bit more. But I think it's appropriate tonight to just talk about the profound importance of this book. Okay, that's it for me.